Good morning, dear students. I will be speaking something about Dr. B.R. Ambedkar's prose essay, Gandhism, the Doom of Untouchables. Before speaking much about this particular prose essay, I want to clarify certain things. One, we are going to analyze this essay just as a prose text to be studied under the syllabus of Indian Writing in English. Number two, the analysis of this essay will be completely objective and it does not have my subjective opinions regarding either Mahatma Gandhi or regarding Dr. B.R. Ambedkar, but I am going to analyze objectively what is there in this essay, how Dr. Ambedkar has criticized the view of Mahatma Gandhi and for what reasons he has been criticized by Dr. B.R. Ambedkar. So we have to take this subject as very objective one, because both Mahatma Gandhi as well as Dr. B.R. Ambedkar are greatest leaders our country has ever seen. Leaders always lead the people towards one common goal, but their ways and methods may be different. Gandhi's ideologies were different. Tilak's ideologies were different. Nehru's ideologies were different. Dr. Ambedkar's ideologies were different. Savarkar's ideologies were different, but all of these leaders tried only for the betterment of Indian society, and this we have to keep in our mind when we study any particular essay written by one of these great leaders. So it is very clear that it is going to be an objective analysis of the text under study. We need to focus on certain aspects before actually plunging into this essay. What is Gandhism? We need to understand what is Gandhism first. All the principles propagated by Mahatma Gandhi during the struggle for Indian independence can be termed together as Gandhism or Gandhian philosophy. When we listen to this word called Gandhism or Gandhian philosophy, certain terminology comes to our mind. The words such as Gram Swaraj, Swadeshi movements, peace, non-violence, religious beliefs, and unification of India come to our mind. We know the general attitude of Gandhi, Mahatma Gandhi, towards his freedom struggle. He was a man of peace and he seemed to have supported the cause of non-violence and truth until his end. He did not want to disturb the existing situation. He did not want to create a chaos which was already existing in the Indian society during the British rule. So his movement towards freedom supported silent movements and the forms of movements such as satyagraha, non-cooperation, and so on. So we know about these ideals of Mahatma Gandhi. But in this essay, which we are going to study now, Dr. B.R. Ambedkar looks at Gandhian ideals from the perspectives for the Dalits. What Gandhian philosophy or what Gandhian thought has given to the untouchables? Has it solved the problems of the untouchables? Has it given them an equal status in the society? Has it really brought them to a very good level, economic level in the society? How and to what extent Gandhian principles have helped, or whether they have helped or not, the untouchables? This is the matter in question in this particular text. So to understand this text, first we need to look at certain aspects which are already known to us but are often used in this context. One is the Varna system. We all know that the ancient India had this system of classification in the society. People in the society were distributed into these four classes, where those were called as Varnas. The first Varna is that of the Brahmins. The second Varna was that of the Kshatriyas. The third Varna was that of the Vaishyas. And the fourth one was of the Shudras. This Varna system depended mainly on the profession of the people. The Brahmin Varna was supposed to undertake the professions such as teaching, medicine, astrology, and worship of God. The second, that is Kshatriya Varna, had to take up the responsibilities of being soldiers, Kshatriya, the soldiers, and the warfare. Their participation was in the warfare. The third one, Vaishyas, that is the class who would engage themselves in the commercial activities of the state, thereby supporting the business and economy of the whole state. The fourth Varna, that of the Shudras, that was meant for the professions which mean service provision to others. Services, various services such as barber, cobbler, blacksmith, and many other professions which are service oriented, which come under the domain of public service. Those were meant for the Shudra Varnas. This Varna system had nothing to do with the birth. For example, if a son or a daughter is born to a Brahmin and that son or daughter wants to engage oneself in business activities, he or she will not be considered as Brahmin. He will be considered as Vaishya. Or if a son of a Brahmin engages himself in military activities, he will be called as Kshatriya. So, the Varna system never depended on birth of a certain person, but it depended on the profession of each person. No matter in which family you are born or in which Varna you are born, if you follow a certain profession, that will be your Varna, and you will be judged on your Varna like this. So, this is Varna system as it was designed in the Vedic and post-Vedic times in India. Further, it led to some sort of problems wherein possession of knowledge meant possession of power, and certain people belonging to the high class, that is high Varnas, started considering the other Varnas as low. So the hierarchy came into practice, and this led to the horrible system which is still existing in India, that is caste system. Now this caste system is different from the Varna system. In Varna system, you are judged by your profession, whereas Unfortunately, in the caste system, you are judged by your birth. If you are born to a cobbler, lifelong you will be considered or labeled as a cobbler. Your job or your profession is predetermined by your birth. If you are born in a Brahmin's family, you will be Brahmin forever throughout your life. That is what is called as the caste system, in which your status depends mostly on birth and not on your profession. Whatever profession you choose, once you are labeled as belonging to certain caste, you will be labeled forever. So this caste system became absolutely a cruel system for the society of India, because once the low caste people were labeled as low, they were always tortured, exploited, and they were always dominated by the upper castes. There became a hierarchy in the caste system. Brahmins started considering them as supreme. Then the Vaishyas considered themselves as supreme, and unfortunately the fourth Varna, which was there, the Shudras, they were the most downtrodden people in our country. Later these are the people, the Shudras or the fourth Varna, came to be considered as the lowest in the caste system, which was an unfortunate development. These Shudras were exploited, tortured, humiliated, insulted, and kept away from the mainstream of society for several centuries in India. They were not given basic rights. They were not given access to education, healthcare, and even the basic amenities like water and food as well. So this was a very cruel and harsh system which existed in India before independence. To some extent it still remains. The stigma related to caste system still haunts India, even though efforts are being made by the people of India to overcome this trouble. So this is about the caste system. We need to understand the difference between Varna and caste system. Varna, your status is determined by your profession. In caste, your status is determined by your birth. So these two things we should be clear about before plunging into the prose essay written by Dr. B.R. Ambedkar. Further, we need to also understand how this caste system led to certain socio-economic conditions in India. As a connection was established between profession or labor and caste, economy also started playing a great vital role in deciding or determining the status of people in India. The Brahmin caste preferred to do the white collar jobs, and that job was considered to be a high quality job. Even to this day, there are divisions in the labor or divisions in the work or professions that we do. We still consider some jobs as white collar jobs and some jobs as, dark jobs, dark handed jobs. The words represent the hardships. White collar jobs means you don't have to physically toil yourself too much, and you don't have to spoil your clothes. That is white collar job. There is still a lot of stigma attached to this division of labor. And mostly what happened is the people belonging to the lower castes remained into labors, I mean various sorts of daily wage labor jobs, and the people in the higher castes got opportunities to educate themselves and gain some positions in white collar jobs. This naturally created one more hierarchy. First, there was already a hierarchy between castes. Now this caste hierarchy led to hierarchy in economic class as well. The white collar jobs represented a rich society, and the other kind of jobs such as workers in the factories, agricultural laborers, then daily wage laborers, and the other manual works. Such people started remaining poor. This created an economic divide between the people. This led to class struggle. Now this can be connected to the theory of Karl Marx. We can easily connect it to Marxism. In Marxism, there is a concept called base and superstructure. What is base? Marx says that the society is divided into two clear-cut distinct divisions. One is the base, and the another one is the superstructure. Bourgeois and proletariat. Proletariat class or proletarian class consists, or it makes up the base of society, and the bourgeois class makes up the superstructure of the society. So if you look up at this concept as a pyramid, the base remains in the low level and the superstructure remains in the top level of this pyramid. Now what happens? What is the difference between this base and superstructure? For the people in base, these people mostly consist of labor class people, daily wage laborers, industrial workers, hands at farms and agriculture and so on, who do not have access to richness or a good amount of money and proper education. Since they struggle to meet two ends of their day, all their efforts, time and energy is lost in heavy work just to fill their stomach twice a day. They don't have leisure. Now remember this word, leisure. Leisure is very important concept discussed by Dr. B.R. Ambedkar in this particular essay. So the people in base always are busy in heavy physical work or physical labor, and that's why they are not able to spend time for the other activities such as cultural production. Like for example, I'll give you certain instance. Think of the people in the rural areas who are busy throughout the day in agricultural activities. And think of the urban people who work for a certain amount of time in a day and rest of their time is spent in leisure activities. Where do we find cultural production more? Is it in the cities or is it in the villages? Of course, folk culture is there in the villages, but that cannot be at the center. Although it is coming into the center now, but still, people in the villages have less time to spend for the other activities such as entertainment, music, production of literature and other creative activities, because their time and energy is spent in working throughout the day and satisfying their basic need of hunger. Now this is what is the fate of the people in base, as spoken by Karl Marx. What about the people in the superstructure? People in the superstructure are chiefly industrialists, capitalists, and white-collar job people. What is the benefit that superstructure is getting from the society? It has a lot of money, first. Second, the superstructure, people in the superstructure do not have to worry too much about 2 times meals per day. They get it easily, and they have to work only for some time of the day, and the rest of the time they can spend for entertainment and other cultural activities such as reading, writing, education, and so on. They can afford to go into clubs, places of entertainment like theaters, and involve themselves in cultural activities. They can afford to do that. And that is why always what happens is culture of a society is determined mostly by the superstructure, although the scenes are changing now. So this we need to keep in mind. Marxism also has connection with this essay. So the people in the superstructure have a lot of time of leisure. Now leisure is very important if you want to involve yourself in cultural, social, and other economic activities as well. This is lacking for the people in the base of the society. Next, there is a discussion about machines. Machine, whether machine is good or bad, has been discussed in the essay thoroughly by Dr. B.R. Ambedkar. There is a need of machines in the present times, because machines is the human efforts. Machines save human time. And when machines save human time, the same time can be used for leisure, in which creative activities and cultural activities can be undertaken. And this is why machines are important. But at the same time, there is also the other side of the debate, wherein machines prove to be dangerous to the humans, because machines, if they replace humans, many humans will turn jobless, and that is a threat to the economy of a society. So there is a lot of discussion about machines. Now we will go into the details later when we actually plunge into the text of this essay. So machines are good or bad, we will discuss according to B.R. Ambedkar. What are his views regarding machines? What are Mahatma Gandhi's views regarding machines? The things will be clear when we look at the text. So this essay focuses on social views, economic views, and socio-cultural views as well. How certain ideologies can bring up equality in society, how certain ideologies hinder the progress of a particular class in society, all these things are very clearly discussed in this essay by Dr. B.R. Ambedkar. Now, general aspects about this essay I will discuss. This is a prose essay written in 7 parts by Dr. B.R. Ambedkar, and it is a lesson or a chapter in this book or anthology of Dr. Ambedkar's prose essays entitled What Congress and M.K. Gandhi Have Done to the Untouchables. So Dr. Ambedkar has looked upon the policies of the Congress government before the Indian independence from the perspective of a Dalit champion. He critically approaches at the various policies and the thoughts and attitudes of Congress people, whether they really cared for the upliftment of the untouchables or the Dalit communities. This is debated in this book by Dr. B.R. Ambedkar. The original title of this essay is Gandhism, the Doom of the Untouchables. The title looks a little bit controversial because Gandhi, we consider him as the father of our nation. And then Gandhism, how can Gandhism be doom? Doom means, we know what is doom. Doom is utter failure, right? How can Dr. Ambedkar call Gandhism as the doom for the untouchables? He has not called Gandhism as a total doom, but for the untouchables, it is a doom, according to Dr. B.R. Ambedkar. And to justify the title, he takes a lot of examples, he takes a lot of references from Gandhi's books and systematically goes on evaluating his views and analyzing Gandhi's views and principles, thereby criticizing each of them very systematically. So this essay has argumentative style and critical in approach. First, he presents Gandhi's views very clearly, taking references from various books and works written by Gandhi. Later on, he goes on taking one by one to the discussion, and thereby he gives his own views and comes to conclude that Gandhism has failed utterly to solve the problem of the untouchables. Gandhism, which looked promising as a philosophy that would solve the problems of the Dalits, in fact, it did not solve any of the problems. Rather, it was an impractical approach to the solution of the problems of untouchables. This is what Dr. Ambedkar has tried to say in this essay in a very systematic manner. So we will start with the discussion in detail in the next lecture. Remember once again that these are not my subjective opinions. I am repeatedly telling this because this can be taken as a controversial subject. But both the leaders, whether it may be Mahatma Gandhi or Dr. B.R. Ambedkar, were great leaders of our nation. It is only an objective discussion, analysis that I am doing as it is mentioned in this particular text. So, next lecture will be on the detailed analysis of this short prose essay.